going on, guys? Johnny Alonzo.
Johnny!
Hey. Good to be here. Cut it, Scotland. The new franchise, Coffin. She's also a producer for Coffin and Coffin 2. I don't know, I've got a lot of stuff, man. Just looking at Johnny Alonzo.com. Passing it on.
Hey, I'm Tom Woodley. I am the executive creative director of a company called Electus. We have 25 shows on television, everything from Chopped, Marco Polo and Flick on Netflix, Jane the Virgin, Ugly Betty, Adam Ruins Everything, a bunch of other stuff. We also own College Humor, and so I run the team that does that. I'm also a web creator who, along with Darren, on the end, created some of the kind of the first long-form web series about 10 years ago. So I always love coming to these things and meeting people who are doing it together.
I'm Tracy Faraway, and I'm in the web series First Day. It was produced by Owl Entertainment. They did Gossip Girl, which are great shows. Basically, it was Groundhog Day, but with me. Then I also did a film called Hologram for the King, where I played Tom Hanks' daughter in that, so I'm a redhead, in case you're wondering. And then I also was in Enough Said, where I played Julie Louis Dreyfus' daughter, and I'm a brunette in that. Though I'm naturally blonde, I don't know why they did this to me. Just my path, I guess. So thank you guys so much for being here. We appreciate all of you, and this is really exciting for all of us, so we can't wait to get this thing killed off and set.
I remember you in Enough Said. Now I can see it.
Yeah.
My name is Aaron Strauss. I am the producer and writer. I currently work as a digital producer for NBC Universal. By way of creating independent web series, I created a web series called Downsized, and then I created another project that ran on my web, that won some awards.
We have some of you that are actually producing web series and the actors who are acting web series. What I'd like to do is find out what is the difference between a web series as opposed to a regular series, and then how does social media help and harm you in the process?
You're passing my... Fair enough. What's the difference between a regular series and a web series? Increasingly none. I mean, really, what we're seeing now is sort of the great convergence of all types of, you know, it basically is there's different platforms, if you all know, about different channels. They all have their own strengths. Sure, there's like production differences if you're making a show for Instagram and if you're making a show for Netflix. Obviously, there's differences, but... you know, increasingly they're all going through the same television development process where you're raising money and pushing and all that stuff. On the indie series side, of course, it's, you know, you make whatever you can and it's whatever platform you enjoy making for. I'm going to pass the mic to someone else for the social side of that thing.
Okay, well, it's a twofold question, right? So I guess the first part of it obviously was the difference between a web series and a regular series. I'd be fortunate to be both. I guess the difference is web series also go a lot faster. You know, they're filming them a lot faster. They might be sometimes a little bit shorter than a 30-minute or an hour show. So it's kind of fun in that way because you get to work a lot faster if you're a fast-paced type of person. Maybe I am. But with the series, it's great because you also need to have the advantage of having more cameras sometimes, or you know, you have maybe people with more backing or who have done other credits. Sometimes but it's could be their first foyer, and if it blows up, you know, that is new media. That is what we are here for today, and that's what it's all about. Whereas with the series, like, we've been doing this for how many decades? You know, the TV, it's been a long time, so we're really reinventing kind of what television is and what internet is. And then I guess the second part of the question, what does social media do in effect to these kind of things, good and bad? Obviously, it's a double-edged sword, right? Social media can be so great in getting the word out and different things, but if you say one wrong word, like no one's gonna watch your show, or no one's gonna do whatever, so you really gotta watch it in that sense. But at the same time, you know, social media allows us so much freedom, and that's what's beautiful about online things, is we get to be who we really want to be, and it can speak the truth sometimes to a wider audience. So I think that helps However, you know, you get into the things where you got a lot of great actors from audition, and then they go with someone that's got a million Instagram followers, and then they recast them. It's like, why go through the trouble and the process? You know, okay, you wanted somebody popular who like maybe could be free advertisement for you, but you don't realize the repercussions. You know, when you've got people that are trained and that know their stuff, they know their lines, know their blocking, you know who they are, know who the character is, that's invaluable. I mean, you could pay $1 million for that if you wanted to, but luckily most actors will not charge that much, you know? So I think that's another big difference there, just with the social media. Darren, what's your take?
I have a kind of different take because I see web series and television series as two very different things. Like Amazon and Netflix and all that stuff is a television series that just happens to originate online. And then web series, I would group, you know, as more of a digital initiative. When you're doing something digitally, then you really should be thinking about
it.
That's why all of these, I work a lot with influencers, so a lot of YouTubers and Instagrammers, and some of them are big movie stars now, and, you know, they're The way they are big movie stars is that they connect with the audience and they use social media as a content tool and a connection tool. And I feel like, you know, some of the biggest web series like The Lizzie Bennet Diaries, which I worked on, which was, you know, huge and heavy, they really understood that it was a digital show. And the way The Lizzie Bennet Diaries was a modernization of Pride and Prejudice, but it was told from the perspective of Lizzie Bennet as a YouTube blogger. And so they really used YouTube in the format that it was meant to be used, and they used the storytelling that was meant to be used, and all of the characters within that world ended up as Instagrammers, and were on Pinterest, and were on Twitter, and they were kind of using the native forms of digital content. And to me, that is a web series. And those are the ones that are very successful, and using social media as a content creator is a very interesting thing. I think you have to really think about how you can use it in a storytelling fashion, and how you can take your show, which might have linear storytelling in it, and figure out a way to make it interactive and inclusive, and use the technology that it's built on, and that's the way to take your little small independent series and make it.
Now, everyone answered the question except Mr. Johnny Alonzo. So now I'm going to make it harder for Johnny Alonzo. Johnny Alonzo, you have been both on episodic television and you have been in web series. You are also a producer. You work together on The Hawkins. I want to hear from you in terms of distribution and how you get a film in versus a web series distributed and funded, what the major differences are.
Well, funding is just funding. I mean, you have to have some money with a big bank or whatever the size of your budget is. You have to have it covered, right? So you start with that. We'll get into that in more detail. Like yourself, we're both producers in Los Angeles. We both produce Coffin, too. You know how much time you put into it. It's not easy. It was a lot of work, right? When it comes to, like, funding, let's just talk about an independent film. Of course, you have to knock out your budget. You have to know who you want, what your audience is going to be. In order to get good distribution, really, you have to have a film that's at least within a certain amount. You can't make a $20 budget film and think that Artists of Entertainment is going to pick it up and distribute it nationally, internationally. You have to be within at least the boundaries. When you shop your film, you're going against the odds. I mean, it's not easy. I mean, that's why anybody can shoot a movie, anybody can produce a film. But what separates you and differentiates you is that you have distribution. I mean, our film, we got national distribution right off the bat because of the original film. But we got better distribution, and now we have foreign and international and all the other platforms, iTunes, Amazon Prime, Netflix, Video On Demand. And it's doing very well, but I mean, it takes a lot of work, a lot of dedication. It's not easy. When it comes to distribution for a web series, I don't know that, actually. I've only been on one web series called Milgram and the Fast Walkers, which is kind of like a sci-fi film noir. Cool series. And I was nominated for Best Actor last year at the Independent Series Awards in Los Angeles. I didn't win. It's all right. But let me tell you something, man. I never thought that event was going to be as great and grandiose as it is. You know, we've been to the Emmys. You know, we've been to the award ceremonies. This Independent Series Award, you felt like it was a gala event. I mean, it was real. This whole web series thing is huge. I mean, the whole web series community is enormous. And it's not something to be, it's growing. When it first started, you know, you're like, oh, whatever, man, it's web series. But let me tell you, man, that's where it's gone. You know, they both said it, all three of them said it. The difference was episodic, which is like, you know, if you do an hour episode, it's like 54 minutes of shooting. All right? That's about a week's worth of work. You can do an independent series, you can have an episode for 4 minutes. You can have 10 episodes, that's a total of 40 minutes. So it's a different world and it's a different platform. You have to forget, you have to honor what you've learned, because yesterday's words are not today's. It's completely different. And I mean, I really respect the web series makers and people who back it up and push it. Are you happy with that?
Yes.
All right. Where do I shop, my friends? Oh, different houses? Yeah. I mean, I'm very close with Artist View Entertainment in Burbank. I'm very close with New Line Cinema, of course. And there's, well, you're talking about the festivals. Of course, the Cannes Film Festival and the French Riviera. But I think there's so many. I mean, there's Sundance. Of course, Sundance, though, is mainly big budget of films these days. But back in the day, it used to be any indie. Now they've bumped it up where you have major stars in independent films. But I don't know, independent, they're backed up by the houses. Slam Dance is now taking the indies in the web series, but it's very tough to get in. It's a racket, but you have to be involved. You know, and I keep telling Lucky, you have to be in the mix to get in the mix. It's not an easy game, but I mean, perseverance and the right people, and you center yourself in the right hub, it works. I mean, we're a test lab. I mean, we got Coffin too. It's got a great distribution deal. We should be seeing royalties soon.
So this is what I want to ask you guys. Because there is a difference between the independent film and a series and a web series. Everybody's talented. That's why you're here. But like you said, you can produce something and then you've produced it. It has to go on. So what I want to ask you is, how did you shop your web series? Because a web series you can't really take to festivals, or can you?
So I guess I might be sort of a special case in that I made my web series in 2006 and no one else was yet. So I kind of got a lot of press just by being one of the first people doing it. And frankly, that's what gave me my agent, and that's what got Michael Eisner has a company called Guru, which paid, paid to make web series. And so he was doing that with me for a couple of shows. So that was basically luck of the draw that might work out first, but of course execution is everything too. So in terms of like the marketplace, the difference between film and web television is like, look, you can send your film to a festival and there's a marketplace for that and theoretically someone will buy it. That does not exist for web television. So you all are making your web series and that's great, I've done it, you're doing it, no one's gonna buy it. I'm just going to say that flat out, no one is going to buy your web series as is. That doesn't mean that it can't be successful, but I'm not going to buy it, no one's going to buy it. And the reason is, when we're buying stuff, it's like, we're buying for, already existing audiences. So like College Humor, for example, part of my company, has been around since 1999. We are the number one most subscribed comedy channel on YouTube, but that's because we've been building it for so long, 12, 13 million subscribers, however much we have. That's all that people really want to see is like, what's the scale? So we're not, none of the people with big scale numbers are going to take a risk on distributing something that they make themselves or something. So really it is, I wish there was like a marketplace, and I know that, we've been talking for years about how there needs to be like an indie film marketplace the same way that there is. Great, that's right, yeah. Oh, okay, well, yeah, it's super simple. We'll just start. But until there is, I mean, it's sort of like what this really is like you're making your best work, you're making it a calling card, you're meeting people, you're getting it out there, and then it is going to television. I mean, like Broad City and Drunk History and all those shows. And that's the only, that's really, truly the only path right now.
I mean, as far as producing, don't work with Weinstein. Like, no. It's a no.
No, but with First Day, the web series that I did, that was produced by Alloy. Very close ties here, Alloy. So they obviously did Gossip Girl and a lot of great network television shows as well. So that's why it was cool, because we had a lot of funding and we had all this, but I mean, as an actor, you know, kind of kept in the dark until we're lucky enough, you know, to move into the higher ranks and divulge all the secrets of the producers. So I don't know all of them yet, but I do know that there are, you know, producers that, when they are involved in web series anyways, could be really good. It could be really good people that work on network television. So that is an advantage for anyone that wants to just start filming YouTube videos, or, you know, it's still up on Vine, or, you know, your Instagram videos, or whatever you want to do. Do it. Do it. Like, make your story. Let us see your life. I always say, my life is not boring. I wish sometimes I was more boring, but everything is always happening in my life. Something is always happening that's, like, I don't know, I can't explain it, you know? And this is content, unfortunately, for us sometimes, you know? A lot of people find it very entertaining. So if you have anything going on in your life, and you have that kind of stuff, or you have a storytelling ability, or a writing ability, or a producing ability, start putting your stuff online, you know? Because you don't know who's going to see it. And I've gotten so many messages from people that I never thought I would, just because they put on something silly, and I was like, oh, I should delete this, or this is weird, and, you know, somebody says, wow, this was ingenious, and I'm like, what? Like, it can happen, and I think that anyone that wants to get involved, please do it. Please start putting your stuff online more, you know? That's what our future is going for. We're making the feature content, and that needs to happen. You know, there's going to be a film, television, and web revolution here pretty soon, and we're all at the forefront. So, you know, let's all kick it off together and let's all get it out there. I mean, we're all in this together, so that's what my best advice, I guess, would be. I don't know that much about producing.
You do.
I do. I'm
one of the producers here. I just agree with my lovely friend Tom about that there are, we've been old friends for a long time, so I can disagree with them. And then I can pass it back to the next one. I do believe that people do buy like web series, so I don't think we should leave this event to pass the I think that one of the things that you can do, is you can be a self-distributor and you can put your web series on YouTube or Vimeo. A lot of, and you can build a following through doing that, you can run ads doing that and build a business doing that. And then what will happen, which happened with series that I have worked on or have been connected to, is that then people will come to you and they will want to buy your series, they will want to, the brand will want to sponsor it or get in on it, and that's how you will sell your show. And then there is the other avenue, which is that you're not trying to necessarily build a huge online following, but you want to get a television show or get something happening in that venue. Which, you know, Issa Rae did, where she took Miss Adventure 2000 Black Girl, which was a very successful YouTube series, and now she has an HBO series, which is also very successful, called It's a Girl. And then Broad City obviously did that, where they were on Comedy Central. There's a show that's on TV Land, I think, called Teachers, which is also a web series. Crazy Ex-Girlfriend came from a YouTuber. So, it's not your autobiography. So I think that you have to make a choice, though. If that's what you're, well, I guess you, I mean, I think you should have a, you should have a strategic plan. And if your choice is that, hey, I want to be Issa, then, you know, you're creating a series that shows your voice and that fills a void that's missing in the program. Or you are trying to build an online audience, and if you're doing that, then you have to be smart and think about, you know, where can I get that audience, and do I need to have people that have an audience built in, that do I need to put influencers on the show, or how do I activate my online audience? But you know, those are the ways that you get money in the end. It's hard to get money when you don't, when you're still building value for yourself, so you just have to kind of be strategic about what is your strong point and build your content around that. And you obviously all have good content because you're going to be there, so don't be depressed.
So we're going to take some audience questions, but really quick, I just want to ask you guys, where are you based?
New York City.
Based in Hollywood?
75% New York, 25% Hollywood.
25% Los Angeles, 75% New York.
I did that on purpose because I want everyone to be able to try no matter where they are geographically. So, does anyone want to ask a question? This is a Marvel's panel. Be brave, be brave. Don't hold back.
Come here, come here.
Get on the microphone.
Hi, we keep on hearing the talk about building your brand, building your platform, taking your concept, and thinking about it in a much broader vision. What aspects of the platform are most important? I think about merchandising, selling t-shirts, the spin-offs. Talk to us about the bigger brand and platform and how to get there beyond just the creative idea of the production itself.
Wow, that's a load of...
Yeah. Is your web series online?
Lady Tips, yes.
Yeah. So is it, what platform is it on?
YouTube.
YouTube, okay. So I think first you have to make a decision about where you're going to post it, and you know, Vimeo is a really good platform if you're like a really hardcore filmmaker and it's like, you know, you're doing some cool things with your camera. It's like a filmmaker's community, and so they do something where they have staff picks, and so they'll kind of curate through content that's posted by users, and they'll find, you know, stuff that's really cool. But usually it's stuff that, like, you know, is filmmakery and has some, you know, something really cool about it. And so, you know, that if you created that type of content, then you want to post it there. YouTube is a great place to post general, but it's a great place to post, I feel like, if you have stuff that's like a bit more virally, you know, that is kind of shareable in that way. And you know, you want to be smart about how you, like, all the metadata that you put in there, so like what you put in as a tags and how you title it and what's your thumbnail and all this kind of nerdy stuff that really matters with YouTube because it's all based on algorithm. Whereas Vimeo isn't, so Vimeo is really kind of hand curated content. And then, you know, so I think you start from there and just make sure you're optimizing your content. And then, you know, I don't know that merch really does that much unless you have a really huge built-in audience that's already there. I think where you want to invest your money is in trying to promote it. If you're on YouTube, you can actually promote your videos through YouTube. You can spend a little money on getting those pre-roll kind of stuff, and so you can bump your views up and get people that